Good morning, all the students. Let's start our lecture, seventh lecture under module 5. In the last class, we have seen a general approach for deriving confidence intervals, and we understood that concept in accordance with central limit theorem, right? So a central limit theorem states that as the sample size increases, means as a thumb rule, we have understood that a sample size, if it is greater than or equal to 30, in that case, that sample's underlying distribution tends towards a normal distribution. Okay, that is called as central limit theorem. That is explained by central limit theorem. So in a normal distribution, if you see mu is equal to, means the mean, sample's mean will be equal to 0 and the standard deviation will be equal to 1. Okay, so when how we can understand that in simple terms is central limit theorem states that when the sample size keeps increasing, then the underlying distribution of that sample tends goes towards a normal distribution, tends to form a normal distribution or follow a normal distribution, okay, with mu equal to 0 and standard deviation equal to 1. Now in today's class, we'll see how to find the difference in error of two hypotheses. If we have two samples and we have a hypothesis formulated on that, H1 and H2. What is the error in, what is the difference in error of these two samples formulated on this hypothesis? Which formulated those hypotheses, H1 and H2? Now consider the case where we have two hypotheses, H1 and H2, for some discrete value target function. So far, we have seen only hypothesis H, which is derived by training a machine learning model on sample S, training example, set of training examples S. Okay, so H is like a machine learning model. It tells about some fact. It tells us, not fact, it tells us about the performance of a machine learning model. Say if the machine learning model is giving 95% accuracy, then what is our hypothesis here? The machine learning model performs with 95% accuracy and 5% error rate. Okay, that would be our hypothesis. Now consider the case where we have two hypotheses here, H1 and H2, which are tested on two samples, S1 and S2. Hypothesis H1 has been tested on a sample S1 and S1 containing N1 randomly drawn sample, drawn examples, and H2, another hypothesis, which has been tested on an independent sample S2 containing N2 examples drawn from the same distribution. Okay, in this case, suppose we wish to estimate the difference D between the true errors of these two hypotheses. So what is the true error associated with hypothesis H1? It is error D of H1. And what is the true error associated with H2? It is error D of H2. What are these true errors? Now, by now, you should be very familiar with this term, true error and sample error. Sample error is when the model is trained with some sample training examples, it gives some accuracy and it gives some error. Say it gives 95% accuracy, it gives 5% error. That is called as sample error. Now, when you give some new data points to the machine learning model, it again predicts them with some level of accuracy, right? Now, among that, 90% of the data points are predicted correctly. Out of the new data points, 90% of the data points are predicted correctly and 10% are not predicted correctly. In that case, the true accuracy is 90% and the true error is 10%. Sample error is 5%, whereas the true error is 10%. Means there is difference between the sample error and the true error. As the sample error and as the difference between the sample error and the true error increases, we say that the machine learning model is not performing well with the unseen data. The machine learning model is not generalizable. because it is not giving good accuracy with new data points, right? So this true error associated with H1 and the true error associated with H2 can be represented as difference D. D is equivalent to error D of H1 minus error D of H2. True error associated with H1 and true error associated with H2. The difference between them is taken as this D. Now we must derive a confidence interval estimate for D. What do we mean by that? We wanted to find an interval. We wanted to find the area. We wanted to find the chance within which this difference will fall. Say I'm taking a distribution like this. Now I want to know most of the time within which range this D falls. Say I have decided that as 80%. Say I have taken the confidence interval as 80%. Then I am stating that most of 80% of the time, the difference between the true errors of H1 and H2 will fall in this range only. Only 10% of the time, it may fall on a lower range, and 10% of the time it may fall on higher range. Means the difference might be far lesser between the two hypotheses, true errors, or far higher, too higher. Okay, but most of the time that difference falls within a nominal range. Okay, this is why we have to derive a confidence interval to know within which range this difference between the true errors fall. Okay, so we must derive a confidence interval estimate for this D, which is the true, which is the difference between the true errors of H1 and H2, right? Now, having identified D as the parameter to be estimated, now what is the parameter of our interest? In previous cases, what is the parameter of our interest? True error, within which range it falls, or weight of a student, within which range it falls, or the marks of a student, within which range it falls. Okay, these are all called as parameters of interest. We are trying to find within which range that parameter falls into based on the confidence interval. Now, having identified D, in this case, difference between the true errors of hypothesis H1 and H2 as the parameter to be estimated, this is the parameter of interest for us now to be estimated. Now, we next define an estimator. Okay, the parameter that have to be estimated is decided. Now, how to define an estimator? Estimator means how to define the mean of this estimate D. Okay, so the obvious choice for an estimator in this case is the difference between the sample errors, which can be denoted by D hat. Remember, D hat is the estimator. Now we have to calculate difference between the true errors of H1 and H2. For that, we have to first calculate, we have to first estimate the difference between the sample errors of H1 and H2. Understood what I'm talking about? In order to calculate the difference between true errors of H1 and H2, what is the process? We first need to know what is the difference between the sample errors of H1 and H2. Now, if we know the sample errors of difference between the sample errors of H1 and H2, that would provide an estimate of D, which is the difference between the true errors of H1 and H2. Right? Now, whenever we are estimating the performance of a class, estimating the performance of the college, the true error, I might give you a sample of some departments. That is the sample performance of some departments, which would help us to estimate the overall performance of the students in a college, larger population, true error. You're understanding what I'm talking about? Estimating the performance of samples will help us to estimate the performance of the college at a larger scale. Okay, so estimating the performance of students in different departments is called as sample estimation. Now that will help us to calculate the overall college performance, that is of the larger population, right? So in that way, first, in order to calculate the true error associated with H1 and H2, difference between the true errors associated with H1 and H2, we need to estimate the sample error difference. For that, we are taking error S1 of H1, the sample error associated with S1 when it is tested by H1 minus the sample error associated with S2 when it is tested with H2. Okay, that difference is taken as the estimator of D, or we can simply call it as D hat. Okay, whenever there is D hat, we mean it is an estimator, it is an approximation, it is not a determined value, confidently determined value, it is an approximation or a guess. That is why we indicate it with D hat, indicating the estimator. Okay, now we can also show that D hat gives an unbiased estimate of D. Now we are showing that D hat would be an unbiased estimate of D, means there is no difference between D hat and D, right? If there is no difference between the sample error and the true error, we say that machine learning model is highly generalizable. It is performing well with sample as well as the larger population also, as well as the unseen data also. It is performing well with both of them. In that case, there is no difference between the sample error and the true error. In that case, we say that the machine learning model is highly generalizable, right? Now, we can also show that D hat gives an unbiased estimate of D. How can we show that? By showing that there is no difference between D hat and D. Then we can obviously say that it is an unbiased estimate of D, which can be represented as estimate of D hat, that is the mean of D hat, is equal to nothing but D itself. Okay, there is no difference between D hat and D, both are equal. Did you understand? Now, what is the probability distribution governing the random variable D hat? Now we are further interested in knowing the probability distribution underlying the random variable D hat. What is D hat? Difference between the sample errors of H1 and H2 on samples S1 and S2, right? Now, what is the probability distribution governing this difference, whether it is same as the samples? The difference in the sample errors, whether that difference also follows the same probability distribution as S1 and S2. That is the question here. We know that for large N1 and N2, large N1 and N2 means sample size large, means the number of data points in each sample is greater than or equal to 30. In that case, both errors, S1 of H1 and S1 of H2, sample error associated with S1 and sample error associated with S2. Sorry, this is S2. Mark it as S2, right? The difference between these two sample errors follow distributions that are approximately normal. Now, we know that the sample size of S1 is greater than or equal to 30, and sample size of S2 also greater than or equal to 30. Then we have already made an assumption that for the sample size is greater than or equal to 30, the underlying probability distribution tend to follow a normal distribution. Then obviously the difference between them also tend to follow a normal distribution, right? So we know that for large N1 and N2, both error S1, both sample errors S1 and S2 follow distributions that are approximately normal. They are not saying it is exactly normal, but approximately tends towards a normal distribution, right? So D hat will also follow a distribution that is approximately normal with mean D, we are coming towards the conclusion. We are coming towards the proof, right? See here, so D hat will also follow a distribution that is approximately normal, because D hat is difference between the sample errors. No, that, and the samples are sufficiently large. In that case, D hat will follow a distribution that is approximately normal. When it is following a normal distribution, that distribution's mean would be equal to the true errors difference, that is D. Got it? So we understood that D hat would be approximately equal to D, both of them following normal distribution. When D hat is approximately equal to D, then there is not much difference between the difference in sample errors and difference in true errors. I'm not talking about difference in sample and true errors. I'm talking about difference in samples and difference in true errors. Both difference between these two differences is minimal. Okay? So error S1 of H1 minus error S2 of H2. This is indicated as D hat, right? And what is D? Error, true error associated with H1 minus true error associated with H2. Now, difference between this D and D hat is almost zero, indicating that both of them would be the same. Now, it can also be shown that the variance of this distribution is the sum of the variances of S1 and S2. Sample error, here also it is S2, I'm sorry. I'll correct it and send the PPT. It is S2. Now, it can also be shown that the variance of this distribution is the sum of variances of the sample errors S1 and S2. So what is the variance of the distribution? What is the mean of the distribution? It tends towards D, because D hat is following a normal distribution. Now, what is the variance of the distribution? The variance of the distribution is nothing but sum of variances of sample error S1 and sample error S2. Okay? Now, to obtain the approximate variance of each of these distributions, we have the formula to calculate the standard deviation. That will tweak a little so that we'll get the formula for calculating variance. Okay, we know that sigma is standard deviation, and if you apply square, it will be variance. Why? Because when we take sigma square as variance, when you apply square root to it, it becomes standard deviation, so that this and this is cancelled and you are left out with sigma. That is the standard deviation. That is why when we say sigma, it is standard deviation, and sigma square, it is variance. Okay. Now, to obtain the approximate variance of each of these distributions, we have sigma square, that is the variance of D hat. The variance associated with D hat means the difference between the sample errors. How can you calculate that? It is approximately equal to what? The variance in the sample S1 and the variance in the sample S2. So what is the variance in the sample S1? How can you calculate that? Error S1 of H1 multiplied by 1 minus error S1 of H1 divided by the sample N1. We have this formula derived in the previous sessions. If you have a doubt, just refer to the previous videos. You will know how this is formulated, how this is mathematically represented like this. Okay, so it is the variance of the difference in the sample errors is indicated or is approximately equal to sum of the variances in both the samples. What is sum of variances in both the samples? Sum of variance in the first sample, that is error S1 of H1 into 1 minus error S1 of H1 divided by N1. N1 is the size of sample S1, plus this is error in, this is variance in S1. Now, what is variance in S2? Error S2 of H2 multiplied by 1 minus error S2 of H2 divided by the size of the sample S2, that is N2. Got it? Now that we have determined the probability distribution that governs the estimator D hat, it is straightforward to derive confidence intervals that characterize the likely error in employing D hat to estimate D. Now we understood how to calculate, and we have already determined the probability distribution that governs the estimator D hat. We know that probability distribution is following a normal distribution, right? Now it is very straightforward task to derive confidence intervals that characterize the likely error in employing D hat, that is difference between the sample errors, to estimate D, that is difference in the true errors. Okay, so for a random variable D hat, if we take D hat as a random variable, because we doesn't know what would be the sample error prior, right? So we are treating it as a random variable. The outcome is not deterministic. That is why we are calling it as a random variable. So for a random variable D hat, obeying a normal distribution, it is obeying a normal distribution. Why? How we found that? Because the sample size is large enough, because the sample size is greater than or equal to 30, we understood that D hat will obey a normal distribution with mean D and variance sigma square, or I can also say standard deviation sigma. You are following, right? For a random variable D hat, that is the difference between the samples, is obeying a normal distribution. Why? Because the samples are large enough, it is obeying a normal distribution with mean how much? D. Same as the larger population's mean. Okay, so it is D and variance sigma square and standard deviation sigma. The n percent confidence interval estimate for D is, how can you calculate that? It is nothing but D hat plus or minus, D hat is almost the mean of the normal distribution, plus or minus, plus either plus or minus means on either side of the mean, what would be the deviation? It is the critical value Z score multiplied by the standard deviation. That will give you the interval to calculate within which range that D hat falls into, or within which range that D falls into. D is the difference between the hypothesis errors, true errors of the hypothesis, right? So that is calculated by D hat plus or minus on the either side. How much would be the deviation? The deviation would be, say if this is the curve, you're calculating what would be the deviation on either side. The deviation would be plus or minus critical value times the standard deviation. What is the critical value? That is based on the confidence interval. How much value you take for the confidence interval, based on that, from the Z-score table, you can locate the Z-score value, locate the Z value multiplied by the standard deviation. That will give you the interval on this side and on this side within which the range of values fall into. What are the range of values we are considering here? Difference between the true errors of both the hypotheses fall into this particular range most of the time and doesn't fall into this range for some given percentage of the time, right? Now, using the approximate variance sigma d cap square, or if we want to tell in terms of standard deviation, it is just sigma d hat. We can simply call it as sigma d hat. Now, using the approximate variance sigma square d hat, given this approximate n percent confidence interval estimate for d is, how do you calculate that? You represent it like this: d hat plus or minus, either one side it is plus, one side it is minus, the interval you are calculating, plus or minus Z score value times, you already know this, variance in sample S1 plus variance in sample S2 will give you the variance of both the samples together. Apply square root for that, you will get the standard deviation sigma. Okay, now it is very simple. Initially, how did you calculate the variance? This formula. To obtain the approximate variance of each of these distributions, we added up the variance in S1 and the variance in S2. We added them up. That will give us the total variance in S1 and S2, in samples S1 and S2. Now, when we have the total variance, square root of the total variance will give you the standard deviation. So, for that formula, variance in sample S1 plus variance in sample S2, you have applied a square root, which will give you the standard deviation sigma. So, what is your formula to calculate the confidence interval? D hat plus or minus Z sigma, right? So, for this sigma, this is the representation. Now, this expression gives the general two-sided confidence interval. Why? Because we are calculating plus or minus. On either side, we are calculating the bound. We are calculating the interval within which the range of values fall into. So, this expression gives the general two-sided confidence interval for estimating the difference between errors of two hypotheses. We are trying to estimate the difference between error of two hypotheses, the interval into which this difference will fall into. Now, in some situations, we might be interested in one-sided bounds. Means either you are interested in lower bound or only in higher bound. Okay. So, in some situations, when we are interested in one-sided bounds, either bounding the largest possible difference in errors or the smallest possible difference in errors with some confidence interval. In that case, what we do, say we have a confidence interval like this. Now we are interested only in upper bounds, means we want to check whether there is extreme difference in the errors of the samples. Then we keep this open and this one you keep it closed so that it can fall into this interval entirely and doesn't fall into this interval. You are relaxing the lower bound and being rigid on upper bound. That you are okay with the difference in the errors if it is too small, but you are not okay with the difference in the errors of the samples if it is too large. Okay, that is what we mean by this. In some situations, we might be interested in one-sided bounds. Either bounding the largest possible difference in errors or the smallest difference with some confidence interval. Right? Now, one-sided confidence interval can be obtained by modifying the above expression. This expression can be modified now in order to get the one-sided confidence interval. Okay? So, if it is 95%, initially, when it is two-sided, now when we make it as one-sided, it goes up to 97.5. Because 95% and on either side, it has 2.5% tail and 2.5% tail. Now, when you're relaxing it on one side, that will be added to this existing confidence interval, bringing it up to 97.5 confidence interval. You're relaxing one side of the bound and tightening on the other side. So, it is called as one-sided bound. So, this becomes 97.5% confidence interval. Right? Now, although the above analysis considers the case in which H1 and H2 are tested on independent data samples, it is often acceptable to use the confidence interval in the setting where H1 and H2 are tested on a single sample as well. Now, we have taken that H1 is tested on sample S1 and H2 is tested on sample S2. That is why we are taking the sample error associated with S1 as error S1 of H1 and sample error associated with S2 as error S2 of H2. But let us consider that H1 and H2 both are tested on the same sample S. Then what will happen? Let us see. In this latter case, we redefine D hat as instead of two samples, we have only one sample. So just replace S1 and S2 with S itself. So it is nothing but the difference between the hypothesis for the same sample, S. Here, what is the sample we have taken? S. We haven't taken two different samples. We have taken the same sample and tested, H1 is tested on S and H2 is also tested on S. Now, the difference between these two samples, errors of these two samples is defined as D hat. Okay, we can also consider like this. Now, the variance in this new D hat will usually be smaller when we set S1 and S2 to S. Why? Can anybody tell me why the error in this case D hat associated with same sample will be lesser than taking different samples? Can anybody answer this question? If you are following the class properly, you have tested two hypotheses, H1 and H2 on S. And you have also tested two hypotheses, H1 and H2 on S1 and S2 respectively. Means you have tested two hypotheses on same sample and you have tested two hypotheses on two different samples. Now, the errors between these two, which one will be lesser? Obviously, the error between, obviously the difference in the sample errors tested on the same sample will be lesser than tested on different samples. Why? Because S1 and S2 are randomly drawn. When we are drawing the sample data points in a sample randomly, there is no control on the data points we are picking, right? They are completely independent. The draws are completely independent. The picking of the data points, selection of the data points for training is completely independent. In that case, S1 and S2 will have some difference. When they have some difference, their sample errors also will vary a lot. But when this H1 and H2 are being tested on the same sample, the sample error associated with them would be almost the same. Right? In that case, the difference D hat will be far lesser compared to H1 and H2 tested on different samples. So putting as a one-liner, I can say that two hypotheses tested on different samples, the sample error difference will be higher when compared to two hypotheses tested on the same sample. Got it? So the variance in this new D hat will usually be smaller when we set S1 and S2 to simply one single sample, that is S. This is because using a single sample S eliminates the variance due to random differences. This is what I spoke about. It eliminates the variance due to random differences in the compositions S1 and S2. Different samples will always have some difference. That is why two hypotheses tested on them, their sample errors will be, difference between the sample errors will be higher when compared to two hypotheses tested on the same sample. Got it? Now, in some cases, we are interested in the probability that some specific conjecture is true rather than in confidence intervals for some parameters. Sometimes, rather than confidence interval, we may be interested in some statements like, what is the probability that true error of one hypothesis is greater than true error of other hypothesis? Or true error of one hypothesis is lesser than true error of other hypothesis. If you want to know the probability as a statement, okay, that statement, that guess about something is called as conjecture. Means we are trying to make a statement and trying to prove that statement. Okay, still it is not proven. Until it is proven, it is called a conjecture. Okay, you are trying to make a guess and trying to prove it. Now, in some cases, we are interested in the probability that some specific conjecture is true rather than in confidence interval for some parameter. Always, the type of experiment we conduct based on some problem. That problem always may not be calculation of confidence interval. Sometimes it may be a comparison also, like a statement we have to prove. In that case, let us take an example. Suppose, for example, that we are interested in the question, what is the probability that true error associated with H1 is greater than true error associated with H2? Say this is our conjecture. Now we have to prove this by measuring the sample errors and the true errors. Right? Now suppose we measure the sample errors for H1 and H2 using two independent samples, S1 and S2, of size 100. Each of the sample sizes, we are taking the size as 100, and find that the sample error associated with H1 is 0.30 and the sample error associated with H2 is 0.20. Hence, the observed difference d hat, what is the difference? The difference between the sample errors. What is the difference? 0.10. 0.30 minus 0.20 will give you 0.10. D hat is what? Difference between the sample errors associated with H1 and H2. So that difference, we can calculate it as 0.10. Now, what is the probability that the true error of H1 is greater than the true error of H2? Given the observed difference in sample errors, D hat in this case, say this is our question, this is our problem. The sample difference between the sample errors is given. When the difference between the sample errors is given, what is the chance that the true error of H1 is greater than the true error of H2? What is the probability that the true error of H1 is greater than the true error of H2? Equivalently, how can we understand this question is, what is the probability of D greater than 0? D means what? Difference between error, true error of H1 and true error of H2. D equal to, we know this, right? Initially, we have considered D as the difference between true errors of H1 and H2, right? Now, if D is greater than 0, means this is greater than this. That is how we have just transformed our problem. In order to find out true error of H1 greater than true error of H2, their difference should be greater than 0. That indicates that true error of H1 is greater than true error of H2. Okay, so what is the probability that D, this one, is greater than 0, given that we observed already D hat, that is 0.10, means we know the difference in the sample errors. Now, what is the probability that the true error associated with H1 is greater than H2? Or simply D greater than 0, because D is this. D is greater than 0 indicates this sample error as true error associated with H1 is greater than true error associated with H2. Right? Repeat this video, watch this video as many times as you can until you are comfortable with these terms. Right? I am myself repeating it many times, but to be comfortable with all these terms, you have to watch the videos repeatedly. Any mathematical concept involved, if you are not understanding for the first time, do not get scared. Second time, third time, fourth time, you'll surely understand. Okay? Just persistent effort is required, that's all. Now see, we have understood the problem in a different sense. We wanted to know the probability that D greater than 0, given that already D hat, that is the difference between the sample errors, is 0.10. Now, note the probability of D greater than 0 is equal to the probability that D hat has not overestimated D by more than 0.10. Again, this is a game between English and mathematics. We are combining actually both the terms and writing this statement. Listen carefully. Note the probability of D greater than zero is equal to the probability that D hat has not overestimated D. D hat means the difference in the sample errors has not overestimated D, that is the difference in the true errors, by more than 0.10. In that case, there will not be much difference between the sample errors and the true errors. Okay? Or the difference in the sample errors and the difference in the true errors. There will not be much difference between those two differences. Got it? Difference in the true errors is indicated by D. Difference in the sample errors is indicated by D hat. Now the difference between D and D hat should not be more than 0.10. It is not overestimated by more than 0.10. Read this again. Note the probability of D greater than zero is equal to the probability that D hat has not overestimated D by more than 0.10. Okay, because the difference between the sample errors is 0.10. Now to summarize, the probability of D greater than zero equals the probability that D hat falls into the one-sided interval D hat, because we are not having any minus term here. That is why it is a one-sided interval D hat lesser than what? Lesser than the mean of the estimated D hat. The estimated D or D hat. I can call it as D hat. This D hat is lesser than mean of D hat plus 0.10. It doesn't go beyond that. It is not overestimate. It has not overestimated beyond that. Okay. So in this case, this will not cross this particular interval. D hat will not cross this particular interval. It is lesser than this value, mu of D hat plus 0.10. Now, since we already calculated the approximate distribution governing this D hat, we have already calculated the approximate distribution, right? It is following a normal distribution. We can determine the probability that D hat falls into this one-sided interval by calculating the probability mass of D hat distribution within this interval. Do not get confused. Probability mass means what? Again, take a curve and it falls within a particular range, within a particular confidence interval. Okay, so we can determine the probability that D hat falls into this one-sided interval by calculating the probability mass of D hat distribution within this interval. So we are treating it as a one-sided confidence interval. So we are just taking it as on the upper bound or on the lower bound. We are not taking it on the lower bound. Why? Because it is one-sided and we are taking only plus. Okay, so we can depict it like this. It is a one-sided confidence interval having restriction only on the upper bound because we are interested only in the positive term. Now let us begin this calculation by re-expressing the interval. Now D hat is lesser than mu D hat plus 0.10. This 0.10 is the difference between the sample errors. Okay, so this will help us to find the interval over which it will not be overestimated. So in terms of the number of standard deviations, the deviations from the mean, the standard deviations, it allows deviating from the mean. So it helps us to calculate this interval by using this representation. Now we find that sigma d hat equal to 0.061. How do you get this? You know the formula, right? When you want to calculate sigma d hat, it is nothing but square root of sample error of H1 multiplied by 1 minus sample error of H1 divided by N1. This is S1. Okay, plus square root of error of S2H1 multiplied by 1 minus error of S2H2 divided by N2. Add them, apply the square root, you will get this value, that is sigma d hat, and that we can find it to be 0.061 based on the values given. So we can re-express the interval as approximately, how you can rewrite this now, d hat is lesser than mu d hat plus 1.64 multiplied by sigma d hat. Now we have certain confidence interval. Say we are taking 90% confidence interval. In that case, we have the error associated, the z score associated with that 90% confidence interval as 1.64. So you can write it as 1.64 multiplied by 0.061. Okay, so what is the confidence level associated with this one-sided interval for a normal distribution? If you are assuming that it is following a normal distribution, then we can find from z-score table that 1.64. How did we find this? From the z-score table, that 1.64 times standard deviation about the mean corresponds to a two-sided confidence interval with 90%, with confidence level 90%. Okay, so when we locate in the z-score table, 1.64 is associated with 90% confidence interval, 1.28 is associated with 95% confidence interval, like that. Therefore, the one-sided interval will have an associated confidence interval of 95%. So when we take the confidence interval as 90%, 5% is on the lower bound and 5% is on the upper bound, like this. Now, when you take it as one-sided, then this 5% will be added to 90 and the confidence interval becomes 95%. Therefore, the one-sided interval will have an associated confidence level of 95%. Now, given the observed sample error difference 0.10 and the probability that the difference between the true errors is approximately 0.95. This is how we calculate the difference between the true errors and the probability of the difference between the true errors, that D is greater than 0. Okay, so the difference between the true errors H1 and H2, that is D is greater than 0, means it indicates that error associated with H1 is greater than error associated with H2, right? So that, what is the probability of that true error of H1 is greater than true error of H2? It is 0.95, means 95% of the time the difference falls in a nominal range. Only 5% of the time it gives extreme values. So in the terminology of the statistics literature, we say that we accept the hypothesis that, what is our hypothesis? The probability of error associated with H1 being greater than error associated with H2. What is the probability? 0.95. What is the confidence? 95% confidence. Okay. Alternatively, we may state that we reject the opposite hypothesis, often called the null hypothesis. This I have told you already, right? The opposite of the hypothesis we are accepting, that is called as null hypothesis, which we are rejecting, okay? Because there is no sufficient proof to accept the null hypothesis, we are rejecting it. So what is the proof for null hypothesis? Only 0.05%. What is the proof for alternative hypothesis? 0.95. Okay, so null hypothesis is the statement we always want to reject. Alternative hypothesis is the statement we always want to accept. So we have to show that we have sufficient proof to accept the alternative hypothesis and in turn reject the null hypothesis. Now, how much proof did we get here to accept the alternative hypothesis? That true error of H1 is greater than true error of H2. we got 95% confidence interval. That is 0.95 probability. Okay, so 0.95 is the proof, 95% proof we collected to say that true error associated with H1 is greater than true error associated with H2. And what is the alternative proof you have? Only 5%, that is 0.05. That is called as level of significance. That is called as the level of risk you are ready to take in order to accept the null alternative hypothesis. You have a null hypothesis statement, but you don't have sufficient proof to accept it. You have only 5% proof. Now you have alternative hypothesis and you have 95% proof. I'm repeating again, you have null hypothesis, null statement, which you want to reject actually, that you have proof, only 5% proof, support you have. And for alternative hypothesis, which you want to accept, you have 95% proof. Now, you are accepting the alternative hypothesis with 5% risk. Means 5%, you don't have proof in favor of alternative hypothesis. So this 5% is called as level of significance. With 5% level of significance, with 5% risk, you are rejecting null hypothesis and accepting alternative hypothesis. Did you understand? This is how you perform hypothesis testing. In the first instance, it will be very confusing. Just repeatedly read lot of blogs on this hypothesis testing, because this is very important for any machine learning expert. You have to formulate the hypothesis and you have to collect training examples in order to support your hypothesis, in order to prove that your hypothesis is statistically significant. What do we mean by statistical significance? Your training examples are not explaining something by chance. You have sufficient proof for that. That is called as statistical significance. When you are formulating a hypothesis based on the training examples, then we are not formulating that statement because of by chance behavior of the training examples. There is sufficient strong proof in the training examples because of which you have formulated this hypothesis. In that case, we say this hypothesis is statistically significant. It is not formulated by chance. Okay. So in this case, when we take level of significance as 5%, it may be by chance. But 95% of the time you have confidence that it has statistical significance. All the attributes are having some interplay between them in order to prove this hypothesis that it is correct. 95% of the time you have strong evidence. Only 5% of the time it may be by chance. Got it? That is how you determine the level of significance. Now, if you want to be more and more accurate, you reduce the level of significance. Means you reduce the by chance number. Means you make the level of significance as 1%. Means you are saying that 99% proof you have, 99% of the time, your data is showing some statistically significant behavior in order to formulate a hypothesis. And only 1% of the time, some random chance may be associated with it. Okay. So for any critical applications, where you are formulating the hypothesis, you have to take the level of significance as low as possible. Got it, students? Now in the next class, we'll cover how to compare learning algorithms. So when you have different learning algorithms showing good amount of accuracy, in that case, how to compare and select the best algorithm, that we are going to see in the next session. Any doubt, students still here? Antima?
Yes, ma'am.
Any doubts still here?
No, ma'am.
Are you able to follow, students? Okay, then we'll meet in the next class.